Hello everyone and welcome back to another video on the channel. Today I'm going to be reviewing Wonder Woman 1984, and you know, I recorded this video already once before and I decided to scrap it and start all over because the discourse around this movie has been so just controversial and so ridiculous and almost demotivated me from even talking about this movie, because either whichever side you're on, whether you loved it or you hated it, it's either one of those two. There's no in between. There's no you kind of just sort of liked it. There's no I enjoyed it a lot. There's no such thing as that. You either love it or you hate it, and you get torn apart if you're on one side or the other. And so I really didn't want to talk about this movie, and so I didn't review it yet, and I decided to finally do one spoiler heavy. So I will be talking about spoilers throughout this entire review, but I'll mainly be talking about the conversation around these spoilers, around the goods and the bads about this movie. And so that's what this video is going to be about. It's going to be about the conversation around Wonder Woman in 1984. And I also have my review out for Soul, which is why I have that poster up. They both came on Christmas Day. I watched them both on Christmas Day. And I actually have seen Soul twice now. So I did a review for that one. I absolutely loved it. So if you have not already subscribed to the channel, check out that review. And also, I'm going to be doing a video tomorrow, which is going to be just a bunch of movies that I missed reviewing throughout this entire year before, on December 31st, I do my best movies of 2020. And I actually have 15 of them that I have pretty much sorted out. There's a couple movies that I want to watch both today and tomorrow that I have to finish up. I'm watching Mink right now, which I'm about like two-thirds of the way through, and I'm not sure if it's gonna make my list, but that's what my channel is gonna look like for the next few days. So subscribe to the channel for all of that. But let's just jump right into Wonder Woman 1984, full spoilers, and we're gonna go kind of in order of what I loved about it to what I didn't love about it. And I'd say there's two main things about this film that I actually really liked more so than the first Wonder Woman film, which that movie I absolutely love. The first two acts are brilliant, and the third act, although it's not as bad as I remember it being when I first watched it, when I rewatched a few days ago, I still did enjoy the third act of that movie besides that CGI fight. But there's a lot to love about the original Wonder Woman, but the score in this movie by Hans Zimmer is so much better than the original movie. The entire like orchestral themes of that rock and roll theme that you got from Batman vs Superman to now this orchestral version of that in this movie is incredible. I loved the score throughout this movie during almost every single scene. That fight sequence with the trucks, that entire fight on along the desert was awesome. When she learns how to fly towards the end, or whatever she's doing, like swinging through the sky, I loved the music throughout this entire film, and I think it really did elevate it. And also, Gal Gadot is perfect as Wonder Woman. You know, she wasn't necessarily a great actress when she was first cast in Batman vs. Superman, because she was only really in the Fast and Furious movies, which I actually really liked her in those movies with Han. I really liked their relationship, and I thought she was pretty good for those. But when she was cast as Wonder Woman, there was a lot of trepidation for her jumping into this giant comic book role, and a lot of nervousness, because this is Wonder Woman, of course. This is one of the greatest superheroes ever put to page. And she kills it in this movie, even more so than she did in her first film. Her as an actress has really grown, and all the emotional moments in this film work so much better than the first one, because she has just grown so much as an actress in general. And so she is fantastic in this role, in this movie. She's having a blast. And also another thing, you never really get to see your heroes in these superhero movies actually save people. And there are a lot of examples in this film with her really trying to help people, and not just, you know, punching and fighting the bad guys, but a lot of her saving the kids in the mall scene, or those two kids in that truck scene again, like I'm referencing. That scene was probably one of my favorites in the movie, and when she grabs those two kids and she is starting to lose her powers and she lets go of her lasso and she falls to the ground, you're really worried about her and these kids and how much she's trying to protect these people and how desperate she is to save people. It's so well done in this movie. But unfortunately, that is where my positives that are more so than the first one ends. The rest of this movie, I think, is either really, really good to some really ridiculous and some really negative things, which I'll get to towards the end of it. But that is the extent of this movie that I thought was better than the original one. When it comes to everything else, I think it's a little bit weaker. Actually, I do think the two villains are technically better than all three villains in the original movie. The Dr. Poison and Ludendorff and Ares were really weak villains in that first film. But in this movie, you have Cheetah and you have Pedro Pascal as Maxwell Lord. And for the most part, I loved Pedro Pascal in this role. He's the next thing I want to talk about. He was so hammy and over the top, and that's really what this movie was going for. It really did feel like, I mean, there's a lot of 80s nostalgia, and you can, you know, pick and choose whether or not you like that, whether you're burnt out on the 80s nostalgia or you still love it. This movie felt like an 80s movie, and especially when it came to his character, how over the top and campy he was, but it was in such a good way because it fit the tone and the style of this movie, which is another thing I'd like to praise about this movie, because it's so vastly different than that of the original Wonder Woman. Patty Jenkins didn't didn't set out to make a similar movie to the first one. She went and swung for the fences and made something extremely different. And that is something that I have to appreciate, because you can watch both these films back to back like I did and have a completely different experience in both, because they're so incredibly different. And then you have Kristen Wiig as Cheetah, which I loved her setup. I thought her setup was really good, although you can compare it very much to either Jim Carrey's The Riddler or Jamie Foxx's Electro in those two movies, which are the negative examples, or you can compare her to Michelle Pfeiffer in Batman Returns as Catwoman, which I think I'd liken her more so towards that character, and in that way, I think her setup really works. I do wish that the relationship between her and Diana was already established in the movie rather than them meeting for the first time in this film. So I think that could have really helped throughout the movie, especially in their last fight, where there's more of an emotional connection between the two characters rather than just having a little more disconnected and having them just meet and just becoming friends very quickly in the setup. I did enjoy the setup, but I think by the end of it, it does kind of falter and fail because that last fight just didn't have much weight to it, and because the CGI wasn't incredibly great. It was just, it looked a little cat-ish, which it pains me to say, but it really did. And the fight in general wasn't as exciting or as, you know, riveting as some of the earlier fights or as anything in the first movie. And now that I'm kind of piling on into the negatives, then I want to go and get into Pedro Pascal's character, which, like I said, I really enjoyed his performance, but man, things got crazy. Things escalated really, really quickly. There's nuclear missiles in the air. People are wishing for other people to die. And this whole plot of him becoming this wishing stone and being able to grant everybody wishes through the TV particles that are touching everybody is super weird and bizarre. And some of the ways that this power works of, you know, if you're able to grant everybody their wishes exactly how they wish them, it kind of, there's no limit to that. There's no rules. I mean, they can say that there's rules, but there really isn't any rules. Anything is possible at that point. And once everything becomes possible, not anything feels special anymore. Nothing feels special because people can get whatever they want. Like with Diana's character of wishing for Steve Trevor once again, I love Chris Pine very, very much. I think his charisma and his performance in this movie is very good, as well as all the other performances in this film. But his return is very bizarre because he's living inside of somebody else's body. And I know a lot of people have been talking about that, and that is one of the really big criticisms. Why couldn't he just come back? Why is it that she can wish for him to come back, but he can't just appear in his own body being himself instead of being this weird body swapping thing like in Soul? Very, very bizarre comparison that you can really compare those two plot points very much together, but that's what it felt like. And it's very, very strange and bizarre. And this wishing stone, that's another big part of the controversy around this movie, because people can absolutely love how crazy and exciting that this movie gets, because it escalates really fast. And on first viewing, you kind of get sensory overload, and you're kind of taking all this in, and it kind of gives you the illusion of you enjoying the movie because all this stuff is happening. You don't have time to really think about what is happening, and you're just kind of enjoying it in the moment. And in that way, this movie is really fun, and that's why I get that side of the argument of people who love this movie, because it's a very entertaining film. Pedro Pascal's performance and Gal Gadot's performance really sells that, especially at the end when she's talking down with the lasso and talking to the entire world of telling everybody to renounce their wishes. That is a very powerful scene, and both her performances are so great in it. And that reunion of Pedro Pascal and his son and that whole arc, although I wish there was a little more setup to that and a little more, you know, dire circumstances of him really turning against his own son, I really wish there was more of that. But for the most part, I really did enjoy that in the moment. But looking back at it, it really makes no sense, because all these missiles, all these people who wish each other to die, they all start coming back to life, and the missiles disappear, and all the consequences for everything that has happened just kind of vanishes, and there's no consequences by the end of it. We don't know what happened to Pedro Pascal's character. We don't know what happened to all these people in the world who made these wishes and who put harm onto other people. What happened? Do people remember these things? How many people died because of this and couldn't be brought back because somebody can wish that the tires on this car can disappear and that car will run into a building. That person will probably die, and they didn't die because somebody wished that they died. They would have died because the thing crashed. Like in Avengers Endgame, when the helicopter crashes, as soon as Thanos snaps everybody away and the helicopter crashes into a building at the end of Infinity War, those people won't be brought back to life from the snap. They died in the helicopter crash. They died from all the people disappearing, and those people won't come back in Endgame when Hulk snaps his fingers and brings everybody back. Those deaths still matter. Those deaths you know, are not mentioned in that movie, but those things happened. And so in a lot of ways, the consequences from this film and how crazy things get, nothing really happens and nothing really gets amounted to by the end of it. Same thing with Kristen Wiig's character. Whatever happened to her, you never find out. The movie doesn't really resolve itself as well as it could be. And this is a 2.5 hour long movie, and a lot of things happen in it. And it really does drag towards the second act, which is unfortunate because there's so much in this movie. Why does it feel like there's so much missing from it? And so that's where I understand the controversies and the back and forth on film Twitter of everybody complaining about this movie, everybody raving about this movie. It's a very fun and enjoyable watch on first viewing, but you can really tear it apart. And for those people who absolutely love this movie because of that, I understand, because I felt that way walking out of it as well. And honestly, I think I'm still on that side where I really, really, really did enjoy this movie. But all these points that I just said, all these negatives, I understand every single one of them. I don't care though, because I thought Pedro Pascal's performance was so great, and I thought the tone was so well different from the first one that I enjoyed how wacky this movie was and how ridiculous this movie was. It was very entertaining. My mom walked out of this movie absolutely loving it because she doesn't care about all the minor little details. This is a very fun movie. If you enjoyed this movie like I did, enjoy this movie. If you heard all these negatives that I just said about this film, I get it, because I mean, hell, I have all these complaints too. This movie makes absolutely no sense in a lot of ways. But for the most part, I enjoyed watching it. It's a very long movie. I think that's my main concern about this film, is it's very long, and it did drag towards the second act quite a bit. But in the end of it, I was really entertained, and I'd probably watch this movie again. No, it's not better than the original Wonder Woman. It probably ranks pretty low on my DC movies list, but it's well above Suicide Squad and Justice League, so take that how you will. So those are my thoughts on Wonder Woman 1984. Let me know what you guys think in the comments down below, and be respectful of everybody's opinions, and please be respectful about my opinions. I did actually make this review, and I enjoyed talking about it. I was very concerned about it, but you know what? Here it is. Check out my review for Soul, like I said, and of course I'm going to be having a video of all the movies that I missed reviewing throughout this year. Talking about Black Bear, talking about I just watched Wolfwalkers, and Never Rarely Sometimes Always, which, my God, that movie was incredible. All these films that I've been watching throughout this week and throughout this year, I want to talk about all of them. Some of the good, some of the bad, and everything in between. So, thanks guys for watching this video. Subscribe to the channel. I hope to see you all in my next one.